¿Cómo les va? ¿Cómo están? Bueno, sinceramente es un placer para mí poder estar en esta conversación. Agradezco a Takeda la posibilidad que da de aclarar algunos temas con respecto a la enfermedad de Fabry. Y es un gran placer poder presentar al doctor Sandro Feriozzi, quien es un amigo nuestro de Italia, un nefrólogo destacado, quien es jefe de la unidad de nefrología y diálisis del Beccola Hospital de Viterbo, Italia, miembro de la era ETA, editor de varias revistas y un gran referente para todos nosotros con respecto a lo que es enfermedad de Fabry, inflamación de la enfermedad de Fabry y riñón y enfermedad de Fabry. Realmente es un lujo y poder ser chairman de Sandro. Hay algunas preguntas que los nefrólogos nos hacemos permanentemente con respecto a la enfermedad de Fabry y aquellos que no son nefrólogos y también trabajan en Fabry también, que es la detección de enfermedad de Fabry, dónde ir a buscarlo, cómo pensar en la enfermedad de Fabry y que la enfermedad de Fabry no nos sorprenda llevándola por delante, sino saber en ir a buscarla. El otro tema muy interesante que debemos aprovecharlo con Sandro es ¿qué pensamos de la biopsia renal en Fabry? ¿Qué utilidad tiene? ¿Si hay que rebiopsiar? ¿Si no hay que rebiopsiar? Y el tema final, que me parece que es clave en esto, es ¿cuándo y cómo empezar el tratamiento? ¿Cuándo empezar el tratamiento para que el tratamiento no sea tardío, para que no empecemos a seguir la inflamación desde atrás y nuestra llegada como médicos que tratamos sea tardía? Así que los dejo en manos de Sandro. Le agradezco muchísimo su presencia y su participación y vamos a tratar de aprovechar al máximo posible a este amigo y referente de Fabry a nivel mundial. Sandro.
I would like to thanks the Takeda for this kind invitation, and at the same time I would like to thank the invitation my colleagues in Argentina that I consider my friend as community. My talk today will be dedicated to the Fabry nephropathy. This is the slide with my disclosures. And the first question that I would like to address is the screening and the prevalence of Fabry disease in nephropathic population. You know that the Fabry disease is a rare disease, but its prevalence can vary largely. And you can see this slide by the paper of Germain. Why that happened? The first reason that different method, different investigation, different population were at first investigated. And so you can see that the prevalence was very rare or also a little bit common as in north of Italy. Really, the problem was addressed better by the following paper by the group of Gall, who demonstrated that the mutation are not the same. We have mutation that can cause the disease, we have mutation that don't cause disease, and we have the mutation that can cause very mild phenotype of disease. One of important marker was the lyso-Gb3, because Lukács demonstrated that the lyso-Gb3 is very high in male with classical disease and less elevated in female and in other form of disease. The Gb3 was very important because it is the marker for proliferation of muscle muscle cells in vessels, and that was demonstrated by ARTS. The investigation changed deeply when we have the possibility to have the dried blood spot. You know that it's very easy to put a drop of blood in paper, and you can have the dosage of the enzyme, we can have the mutation, and today you can have also the dosage of lyso-Gb3. This method, very easy, changed completely the number of investigation. The first paper that addressed to the investigation according new criteria about phenotype of patients was by Van der Tol, that demonstrated that we have some mutation that are not able to determine the disease. And he started the terms that mutation of unknown significance. And it was demonstrated that if you move from different population with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, with renal failure or stroke, you can have different a number of incidents. In other terms, the incident should be taken into account a lot of factors, not just the enzyme of the mutation of the gene. And they address the problem saying that we have to demonstrate an organ involvement, renal or gastrointestinal or heart involvement of the disease, to be sure that the disease is caused by that mutation. And the number, of course, were lower than previously. So all group, you can see in slide the number from FROST, from Fabry Outcome Survey, and also from Fabry Registry. All people who was investigating Fabry subdivided the population in classical, late onset, on variable unknown significance, because the phenotype was different. You can see this pie man that showed on the base the benign mutation or mutation without disease, and in the highest point the mutation with classical disease. So Dana Donnelly felt the problem that we have to try to be more precise on the number. They screened 63 papers, and the result was that the pathogenetic mutation were absolutely a less number than before. They excluded around 1,000 mutations because they don't cause disease. The mutation were reported, of course, in a number of papers. And the prevalence was absolutely reduced. You can see, for instance, 0.15 females in hemodialysis and 0.21 in patients, males in hemodialysis. The conclusion was that compared to previous finding, we have to think about a less number of Fabry to understand better all this problem about the prevalence. Together with Naples colleagues, with Antonio Pisani, we performed a study, analyzed all papers published, but with very strict concept. Well, first of all, we included the only paper with observational study in hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis. All reporting data, we observed all the screening, evaluating the prevalence, and all paper that had the DNA and analysis with GLA mutation. But not only. When we observe this criteria, we have 36 papers. After that, we perform the analysis only in paper that had that second investigation that confirmed the gender, of course, but the method of say determination, the method of GLA mutation, the prevalence of positive patient, that we have the analysis, we have the reconfirmed results. In addition, we subdivided the mutation in nonsense, small sense, and the insertion, small insertion, and like this. And also we calculate the prevalence on total population and different kind of this mutation. When we perform this criteria, we had only 25 papers that we analyzed to have the results of the prevalence for Fabry patients in nephrological units. These are our results. First of all, I would like to stress that when you perform correctly this analysis, the pathogenic form are less than former, with a later onset are less than the classical form. And this is a very important point, because with a big number, it seemed that the last onset mutation was the prevalence of the disease. Really, the classical mutation seems to be more prevalent than late onset. In the same time, you can see that the different type of mutation, missense and nonsense, in percentage. This is also the final result that we analyzed, and our conclusion were that the prevalence, if you follow all these strict criteria, is very low, because we demonstrated that 56 patients with benign variant, 52 with pathogenic mutation in total of 160 patients. And you can read that the mutations are very slow. And this was our conclusion, and this is our pyramid. So what we can say? We can say that it's very important, it's worthy performing the screening patient, because when we find a patient, we find a group of patients, we find a family, and we can treat or we can study the disease, trying to reduce the patient that will have end stage renal failure after some years. The second point that I would like to discuss with you is the biopsies. Some people ask me, is biopsies helpful in patient with Fabry? The right biopsies, it is important. When to do these biopsies? Well, I would like to show you this case. This case happened in my lab. You know that you invite me and you suppose that I'm an expert nephrologist in Fabry. Well, some years ago, 5 years ago, more or less, I don't remember exactly, I met this patient, a 52-year-old man, in my out-clinic patient's practice, and I saw that this patient had a mild proteinuria, a mild reduction of glomerular filtration rate. You can see that it was 69, is a GFR. He had a cousin with end-stage renal disease, but I didn't pay attention to this point, and his serum creatinine was 1.2, and I carry out the renal biopsies. Honestly, I have to say that I wasn't thinking about Fabry. Well, this is biopsy. You can see three images with PAS, with a max hematocyte eosin, and with resin embedded tissue. You can see that the slide showed that the epithelial cell, the podocyte, showed the vacuolation in the cytoplasms, the same with hematocyte eosin, and the GB3 or lipids were present in a resin embedded tissue. After we studied the patient, we find a mutation and we demonstration that there was a late onset patient. That's why to outline the importance, the role of renal biopsy, not only for Fabry, but in all patients with mild proteinuria. And I think that renal biopsies, when you don't have contraindication, of course, is very, very important. You can see that the best lesion are this vocalization in the endothelial cell. This is a vessel in muscle muscular cell, and in this is in tubular cell. In the tubular, you can see that the distal tubule have the deposition, while the proximal tubules that you can recognize for this line, you can see that is the brush border. Okay, you can see that is a proximal tubules without the deposition. The deposition is mainly in distal tubules and also in glomerulus, as I showed you before. And these are the typical zebra bodies at electron microscopy in podocyte cytoplasm. Another point about renal biopsies. I met a young man with a microhematuria, recurrent microhematuria. and he underwent renal biopsies for this episode. Well, you can see that it was a typical history that was suspected for IgA nephropathy, and he had a mesangial glomerulonephrite. But in this preparation with deposition that are not usually in IgA nephropathy, this is a silver stain argent, methamphetamine inclusion. Immunofluorescent was consistent with IgA nephropathy, this is the anti-IgA antibody, but surprisingly, you can see that he had some zebra bodies in his podocyte. In other terms, we are in front of IgA nephropathy plus Fabry nephropathy. We are a patient with a double pathology. Double pathology is not an exception, it could be observed in Fabry nephropathy. You can see that Vibra described IgA nephropathy and the other authors demonstrated other lead histological lesions like interstitial granulomatosis, SLE nephritis, and is another point in favor of the connection with immunology process and Fabry disease. What is the role for renal biopsy in Fabry? To have a role, we have some authors, the correct histological vision of the Fabry nephropathy. And you can see that it is the paper by Fogo in which this colleague tried to order the Fabry nephropathy, distinguish between glomerular, tubular, and vessel lesion. And it is important if you can compare a renal biopsies at the beginning and after some years, for instance, after treatment. This is the first example that showed the reduction of inclusion in mesangial cells and endothelial cells was the paper by Tuberg. It's a very old paper, and we can see that if we perform a renal biopsy after 7 years, we can have this demonstration, and perhaps the repetition of renal biopsy can be a role. This is the number of deposition, but the things are not so simple as we think, we can think, because in the literature you can find some paper in which the author compared the histological lesion at the beginning and after some years of therapy. This is the paper by Camilla Tondel, it's a very known paper, well-known paper, and it is a paper by Germain that compared the inclusion in disease in vascular, interstitial vascular, endothelial vascular vessel, but Maurer paid attention and he demonstrated that we have a big problem with Fabry nephropathy, as we say very often. In other terms, when you analyze the histological classical picture or slides, you have to remember that the lipids were dissolved by processes need to arrange the slide. And only material from resin embedded is useful for this investigation. Not only, but the volume of the cell can be changed if the cell have the GB3 or the cell don't have GB3. And Maurer introduced the ratio between the volume of the cell, the cytoplasm of the cell, and the deposition of GB3. And he told us, be careful when you compare some different histological papers. So my personal opinion is that a renal biopsy is not useful in the single patients. We need more patients, more studies, and also if you are enrolled in a protocol study can be useful. For in the single patients, my personal opinion is not very useful to repeat because you examine only 10, 15 glomeruli in a biopsy, while only each kidney has 1 million of glomeruli. And if you remember the IgA experience in which we performed the study using thousands of patients, not 10, 20 patients with the disease. If you have atypical renal signs, for instance, we saw that the microhematuria is important to demonstrate that the patient can have other disease besides the Fabry nephropathy. In female, I think that we have to perform a biopsy before to start therapy, because the mild proteinuria that this female can have can be, we have to demonstrate that renal involvement by Fabry disease, because the therapy is expensive, the life of patients is affected by the therapy, and so we have to be very sure before starting therapy. If you suspect a double pathology, I show you the case. And if you are enrolled in a randomized or other multicenter study, you are entitled to perform renal biopsies when, according to the protocol, of course. In this case, you can have result, you can have useful information for the second biopsies. If you have the classical male patient with proteinuria, I think that biopsies can be useful, but not is mandatory. How we can judge that we have a kidney involvement? Yes, we pay our attention for the early signs of kidney involvement. In his kind introduction, Pedro asked me to speak something about the start for therapy. I show you this slide. This is a paper that has been recently accepted by British Medical Journal Open, that we performed in cooperation with all our colleagues all over the world. And the first name you can see is Daryl Hughes. Well, we find an agreement about that the sign that you can read in the lower part of slide are no importance to judge an organ involvement in Fabry disease. Other signs in gray, dark gray, in the middle of the slide, you can see that we find an agreement, but not the consensus about the same signs. You can see, for instance, for cardiac damage, the abnormal PET or MRI. About our kidney, we found the importance of cystatin C, but there is not very complete agreement. The higher part of the slide show that in presence of one of these signs, the treatment or therapy should be started. And you can see, you can read that for our kidney, the proteinuria, the microalbuminuria, the decline of GFR, and the podocyte inclusion are very early signs. We perform this analysis, and I summarize for you in this slide that the early signs for kidney are judged are the podocyte inclusion, a sign that come from Argentina, and we analyze the slide, and the hyperfiltration in patients, in young patients, and also the cystatin and the microalbuminuria. On the left of this slide, you can read the early signs of renal involvement. If you have one of these signs, you can entitle to start therapy with or without, let me say, renal biopsy. Just this, I can say I'm very honored to show you an Argentinian paper. I should say that we have a lot of this paper by Herman Trimarchi, and he demonstrated that the presence of podocyte in the urine, podocyturia, are a very important marker for the early phases of Fabry nephropathy. He performed a lot of study, and this is the last study. He showed that the synaptopontin or polycadalepsin, that you know are the marker of the podocyte, can be present in the urine of patients. And this different marker can be different in different phases of the disease. In the commentary of this study, Sanchez and Nino reported on a scheme to show the localization of this protein, but the important data that remains is the fact that the podocyturia, the investigation of podocyturia, is a very important as early signs of renal involvement in Fab disease. We have, be honest to say, that the technical investigation is complex and it's not easy to have a correct preparation for investigating podocyturia. But this is a very important paper. Other marker can be hyperfiltration. This is our study, again, with Antonio Pisani in Naples. And we demonstrated that if you take a young population in the early phase of disease, you can find a subgroup of patients, 24% in this case, that have an hyperfiltration. This hyperfiltration can be indicated at a very early phase of disease. You can see that the microalbuminuria is less present in this group than this one. In other terms, the hyperfiltration can be an early sign of renal involvement in this case. And it's very important because if you treat this patient, you can have a reduction of glomerular filtration, but it's not a true reduction, it's just a normalization of glomerular filtration rate. And this point was treated some years ago without this definition by Michael West in one of the first papers dedicated to Fabry. And of course, I like to show you my paper some years ago. We published with Germain and Barbey the fact that the cystatin C can be increase its value before then serum creatinine. And this data remain one of the important early renal signs of in Fabry nephropathy. Last part of my lecture or my talk will be dedicated to inflammation. You can know perhaps, and I would like to thank in this occasion Paula Ronsefeld, that you know that she works in Buenos Aires. I had a good collaboration with Paula, and I would like to show you our data based, of course, also in the literature published. First of all, I learned during this year from Paula that lysosomes are different. We are particularly interested to lysosomes that can be have an enzymatic acid that is involved with the immunoreaction. Because you can have this kind of cell that can release this lysosome outside the cytoplasm, and this lysosome can work in the blood, in the serum, and with other cells. You can see that the enzymatic access is different if you have the T cells, if you are microphage, or you have the mast cell. But you can see that this cell have enzyme that can kill cell, and you have enzyme or molecular expression that can talk for immunomodulation, for immune response to the external agents. And this kind of lysosome are very present, are rich in cell of the immune system. So we summarize that the role in the lysosome in the immune system is demonstrated by the presence of major histocompatibility molecule in the lysosome, the presence of perforin enzyme like this in T cells. The presentation lipid is mediated by CD1, is another lipids, and release of pro-inflammatory, inflammatory molecule that now we can see in other papers. The pathologies that alter the lysosomal function, of course, can alter also the immune response. And Paula, an Argentinian researcher, was the father of the mother in this case of the research, because they demonstrated that the patient with Fabry have abnormal number of lymphocytes if you compare with normal patients. And this number can be reduced treating the patients. But not only, these lymphocytes were rich in deposition of GB3. And this monocyte white blood cell can show in external surface a lot of markers like CD1, HLA1, that are able to talk with the other cell of the immune system. Argentina's contribution to inflammation in Fabry was added with this paper by De Francesco. He demonstrated that in normal, in Fabry patients, you have an increase of IL-1 beta, IL-6 interleukin, of course, TNF-alpha, in dendritic cell, in a natural killer, and in monocytes. You can see that the presence of this kind of cytokines was increased in these cells. If you take a normal cell, no cell for normal population, and you expose the cell to GB3 or to an inhibitor of a galactosidase enzyme, DGJ, and you know that DGJ is the chaperone of this molecule, this is another subject, well, you can see an increase of interleukin beta in dendritic and monocyte cell, OTNF, other cytokines. What you can see that the deposition of GB3 is able to stimulate all these cytokines. The most important point is that when you expose this cell to GB3, more is inhibitor, you have an increase of production. But if you expose this cell, GB3, and is inhibitor, stopping before the toll-like receptor 4, you have the stop of secretion. In other terms, toll-like receptor 4 is the point that stimulate is the trigger of the synthesis of this protein. If you stop toll-like receptor 4, you don't have the inflammation, generally speaking. If the toll-like receptor 4 works, you have the inflammation. In clinical studies, Andrea Frustaci demonstrated that the patients, the inflammation is very important, also from point clinical view. Andrea demonstrated that you can have an inflammation myocardiopathy in patients with Fabry disease. And Usler is a neuro investigated the patients, the peripheral nerve, and she demonstrated that TNF is very in high concentration in the peripheral connection, nervous connection, and this demonstration that in clinical patient you can have an inflammation. Back to the kidney, and Sanchez and Nilo demonstrated that the podocyte, normal podocyte, can release fibronectin or type 4 collagen when exposed to the increasing concentration of Lysol GB3, and she demonstrated that this was due to the fact that Lysol GB3 is able to split out a family of protein called the NOTCH1 that are normal present on the surface of the cell. This NOTCH1, when it's split up by the Lysol GB3, is able to activate NFKB. NFKB is a trigger for the synthesis, new synthesis in the same cell, because it's able to modify the DNA and the RNA dependent on the DNA of the cell. This difference protein, synthesis of protein, is able to produce a high increase of secretion of chemokine. You have seen the previous slide that this patient had a high concentration of TNF and other chemokine, is able to modify the synthesis of this protein. In other terms, an epithelial cell acquire the capacity to produce fibronectin or profibrotic cell. It is in, they call this term in transdifferentiation cell. You have the epithelial mesenchymal transdifferentiation, and also the extracellular matrix can be increased by this transformation of the cells. All these processes can be stopped if you stop the secretion of TGF-beta. If you take the cell, tubular cell, you determine an increase of secretion of TGF beta by lysergy B3 if you stop the blocking the inhibitor of the secretion of TGF beta, you have the stop of secretion of this kind of cytokines. And last point, after we try to summarize all this point, is that this paper by Brown. Brown demonstrated in a line, cellular line, that in this case, the gene for GLA enzyme was silenced, and you can see the deposition in gray, in dark gray, of in this cell. He demonstrated that if you have this cell, normal cell, cell with a changed cell, defective cell, cell treated with enzyme, and cell treated with enzyme, blocked enzyme. The result is that when you have the cell treated, this midge, you can, the lysosome are clear, are white, quite white, while here are black, they have the deposition, are dark. Well, when you compare this group, you can see that the split up of notch one protein is very high in cell with this defect. And you can see here, and here you have this difference. The cell with the defect have an increase. But when you compare all this cell with the cell treated, you can see that this differentiation, normal cell, you can see that the cell, for instance, in this case, the secretion of fibronectin, remain independently from the treatment. In other terms, the cell treated with enzyme showed the same result of increase of release of cytokines and also problem, the reduction of the capacity of the autophagia that have the cell that don't receive the therapy. In other terms, the therapy is not able to restore completely the process. As we can suspect, we can suppose that the deposition of lysergy B3 start some processes that after a certain point go independently from the deposition. And we have to treat early this patient because the reaction, the response of immunity activity make this disease progressive independently for our enzyme therapy. And this slide summarizes all this point. You can have the lysergy B3 secretion release in this in the plasma, you can activation of monocyte cell, antigen cell presentation in this case, they can talk with immune system cell and you can have the activation of peripheral blood cell with the release of interleukin beta, interleukin alpha, TNF, and cytokine like this, we have the activation of the innate immunity. So the chain that we call it the chain in FAP in FAP is an immune response, is a chronic inflammation and the tissue fibrosis as final result. And this is the innate immunity, not the acquired own immunity. This is the paper that we carry out last year. Paola is the first name. You can see the, my citation. And we demonstrate that the TGF beta is secreted in tubular cells in vessel less, if any, in glomeruli. And this secretion is associated with transformation of tubular cell, tubular cells, vessel cells, and also glomeruli cells in myofibroblast. We have the demonstration that the deposition TGF beta of the GB3 is able to stimulate the secretion TGF-beta. The TGF-beta determines the transformation of the cell from epithelial or endothelial cell to mesenchymal cell, and this kind of cell are able to release a lot of the TGF-beta and to produce the very subtle inflammation that can determine the renal fibrosis. We summarize our result, and our idea is that deposition happened in all kind of cell. We are speaking about the kidney, in podocyte, in mesangial cell, in tubular cell, in smooth muscular cell. In this cell, we have a reaction that depends on the asset, of enzymatic asset of the cell, you can have the secretion of TGF-beta in podocyte, fibronectin. You have a secretion of cytokines in mesangial cell with the expansion of matrix. You can have the mesenchymal transformation in tubular epithelial cell. You can have an oxidative stress and hyperplasia in endothelial cell. You can have in this point a lot of cytokines and inflammation process involved. The final result will be a pro-inflammatory in the inflammatory cytokines and after in fibrotic lesion. So we can think that the fibrosis in fibrin and fibrotic depend all type of cell. It's not limited to one type of cell. In all type of cell, you have the deposition. In all type of cell, you have the reaction. The reaction depends on the enzymatic asset that any cell, each cell has. So I would like to conclude, summarize that the screening is worthy to be done in patients with Fabry disease, in our patients, in outpatient clinic and in our dialysis ward, because it's very important to find a patient. Found a person, you find a family, and you can treat more people, more patients. Renal biopsies have a tremendous role in diagnosis when you have doubt. In the assessment of therapy, in my opinion, is less defined. The early signs of renal involvement, we can see that are podocyturia, la glomerular filtration, and increased value of cystatin, but don't forget the presence of microalbuminuria and the ratio microalbuminuria creatinine in the urine. Don't forget, please. And after, I think, and we will also for Paula, sorry, we think that an imbalance between inflammatory and fibrotic cytokine is the reason why you can the chronic inflammation and fibrosis in Fabry nephropathy. I would like to thank you for your attention. That was my last slide.
Quiero agradecerle a Sandro esta charla que realmente ha sido un pantallazo muy bueno con respecto a la enfermedad de Fabry, empezando por la búsqueda de la enfermedad de Fabry en los centros de diálisis y en aquellos pacientes de consultorio, cómo pensarlo, la frecuencia del mismo. Luego ese pantallazo sobre nuestro gran punto de conflicto, que es este, o de discusión, que es la biopsia renal. Después, todo lo que es el proceso inflamatorio en el Fabry, que es, digamos de una forma, ese efecto dominó que va generando daño y el cual ya es difícil revertir en muchos de los pacientes que hoy diagnosticamos tardíamente. Así que yo estoy muy agradecido por esta charla. Por supuesto que, como yo siempre digo, cuando diagnostiqué un Fabry, abrí una puerta y del otro lado había 10 puertas más. Y esta charla de Sandro nos expresa esta situación. Así que muchas gracias, porque todavía queda mucho por hacer y mucho por investigar con respecto a esto. Una de las conclusiones que yo he sacado es la importancia del patólogo en poder ver y poder diagnosticar la enfermedad de Fabry, que sea avesado y que tenga experiencia.
The question about the prevalence and how we can perform the genetic investigation screening in our center. Well, I think that we have to perform a screening in Fabry patients in our center at the beginning, a complete screening. After, when you suspect, I say you suspect a Fabry patient and you can perform in a biopsy or other things, you have to maintain high your level of attention, and you can repeat every 2-3 years in new patients the screening. Because as you say, as you comment, when you find a patient, you find a family, and you have to check not only for the patients, but for the family, and you can change, you can modify the life of young patients. We can say now with enzyme therapy, we had modified the outcome of these patients. And is a duty, is you are obliged to perform, to look for a Fabry patient. So I think at cleaning the vessel and every time you have a suspect. On the other hand, with a dry blood spot, it's very easy to perform the investigation. I think that we have to start the therapy as early as possible. What does it mean? I think, and you can, I hope that the paper will publish in short term, and this is the contribution all over the world. You can read, you can, that the start of treatment should be early because you have to stop, to reduce, or ideally you have to limit the reaction of GP3 and the enzymatic asset of the cell. So you can stop, you can prevent, you can the inflammation. And I would like just conclude my answer that I had a young boy, 8 years old, with classical mutation, because classical mutation is the most important. We don't have, well, he doesn't have, he didn't have any signs of Fabry disease except his family, and the lyso-GP3 around 200 milligram. Well, I, without any signs of histological involvement or other sign. Well, I started some months ago his treatment with enzyme because I deeply, I do think that the early treatment is the hope for these patients. We treated our patient, of course, because we have the complication, we have the other thing, we can discuss. But in front of young population is the most important duty for us, because we can modify with the therapy today we can modify in young people the outcome. In other terms, we can modify their life, and it's not less. Okay. The role of pathologists is most important, but we have taken in mind a few things. First, that the signs of Fabry nephropathy or Fabry histological lesion are not pathognomonic. You can find, you know, of course, that the zebra body are present with some drugs, no? And right. we read recently in literature some phenocopies in this kind of mutation. So when you have the suspect, you can resolve the problem very easy with a drop blood spot, and you look for the mutation. You know that chloroquine or other drugs can be have the, also the cornea verticillata, not only the lyso, the zebra bodies. But you have to remember that when you observe a class, routine, in the routine slide for histological examination, you have to remember that you don't see the lipids. You have the negative image. All lipidoses are white at light microscopy. This is, the, in my opinion, a very important sentence that I read some years ago in a paper by Tullio Faragiano, pathologist. All lipidoses are white on the light microscopy observation. At this point, you should be start, what kind of lipidation? Is it a lipidation? What kind of lipidation? Is a Fabry? You can have also the DBS, it is a very important tool for diagnosis. The hyperfiltration in Fabry disease has been already demonstrated, not in all patients, but we can say that all patients can be advantaged by the treatment with the ACA and the ARBs inhibitors drugs. With all kinds of drugs that can interfere with the renin angiotensin system. The analogy with diabetic nephropathy stop here because of the nephropathy, the diabetic nephropathy is completely different disease. But for about the hyperfiltration, I agree, and we are used to prescribe drugs in all patients and patients with hyperfiltration find indication to be protected by the hyperfiltration with drug, with this kind of drugs. I'm favorable to use that, why they use this kind of drug to reduce the blood pressure when necessary, but above all to modify the protein traffic in mesangial GBM membrane. And all patients with Fabry, in my opinion, with minimal renal involvement, as with minimal, I refer to hyperfiltration or very low level of microalbuminuria, should receive this kind of drugs. I hope to answer your question. And I think that antiphlogistic or steroid for drug don't have a role in inflammation. We need the drug that can stop innate immunity, precisely the toll-like receptor 4. But at best of my knowledge, we don't have this kind of drug only in experimental model, and we can translate into human the experience.
Bueno, voy a hacer un resumen. Quiero agradecerle a Sandro realmente esta exposición. Quiero agradecerle a la Sociedad Argentina de Nefrología la posibilidad, al Laboratorio Takeda y a todo el equipo que trabajó y que trabaja permanentemente en estas charlas que realizamos, porque es un lujo trabajar con ellos. Creo que esta charla de Sandro Feriosi, para aquellos que hacemos Fabry, no tiene desperdicio. Creo que nos genera la inquietud de seguir adelante investigando y creciendo en esta compleja enfermedad de la cual tenemos muchos pacientes, de los cuales podemos mejorar el pronóstico y la calidad de vida. Así que espero que haya sido del agrado de todos los colegas, que les haya sacado algunas de las tantas dudas que tenemos y nos haya generado un montón de dudas más para seguir trabajando hacia adelante en la investigación y en el tratamiento de nuestros pacientes. Muchas gracias.